Well, so this is the final performance, and I think you all outdid yourselves. Really, really nice. Well, Ellen, do you want to say something? You haven't said anything. I've been talking, sorry.
I can just tell you that the way this whole opera began I participated as a volunteer in the Atlanta Opera 24-hour opera contest, which is held every year in Atlanta, and volunteer composers and librettists are invited down and they start. We're paired arbitrarily at random with a composer and a librettist per team, and we worked from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. composing a scene. We were handed a prop from the Atlanta Opera prop room, and I was given a flat iron. And my partner was given a bouquet of artificial flowers. And I've been thinking about the Triangle Fire for many years, and that was just the perfect prop. And we were told we would have one male voice, I don't remember if it was a tenor or baritone, and two female singers, a mezzo and a soprano. And, you know, we were told we'd have between 6 and 9 minutes. We wrote a scene. We then went off to our hotels and went to sleep. And then the next day, for 12 hours, from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., volunteer singers and directors directed the scenes. There were five teams. And that night at 7 o'clock, there were public performances of the scenes in front of a live audience and jury. And we didn't win. But I had a great time doing it, and I worked with the composer, his name was Robert Butts, for a little while, and then he couldn't continue because of ill health, and I needed somebody to continue working with, and serendipity led me to Leonard. And
I think it was David Schiff.
Well, it was David Schiff whose work I encountered. I talked to him, he couldn't do it, and he said, call Leonard Lehrman.
And I'll tell you why David Schiff knew me, because I taught the first course ever given in Jewish opera right next door here at Hebrew Union College. And I was assembling bibliography and material for that, and I thought, of course, David Schiff wrote one of the first important Yiddish operas, which is
Gimbal the Fool.
Gimbal the Fool, right. It was done at 92nd Street Y a couple of times. And so I got in touch with him, and I wanted to give him a lecture on Yiddish opera. I actually did give a lecture on Yiddish opera, but Sheldon Harnick came, so we talked mostly about Fiddle on the Roof. That course lasted only two sessions, because the students there unfortunately decided that the Jewish opera was not something they were going to have to prepare or want to prepare for the cantor. But Joel Mandelbaum rescued the thing. I prepared 12 lectures, and I ended up getting 5 at the community church and the Baltimore Synagogue, where I'm the music director for the High Holidays, and Joel was a member of the church. And that was really quite nice. That happened shortly thereafter. And as I say, David Schiff was one of the composers that I had wanted to call on and that I was in touch with. And it's so wonderful that he sent it to me. It was really quite lovely.
And just as a finish for that that opening, Robert and I, our team created a love scene, which was performed, and that ultimately was struck from the opera.
No, so it wasn't struck. It was rewritten.
It was rewritten, but that particular scene disappeared. So even though it started with that germ, the opera evolved beyond it.
What kind of brew around it? I mean, the central scene, the flashback scene where you see the that take place during the fire, that was the centerpiece of what you did, and your idea was to build the opera around that. You came to me with that idea, and I thought it was a great idea. And in fact, that was one of the first scenes that I wrote, and Helene and I performed it on a Valentine's Day concert in Florida, then we started. That was in February of last year. And in March, I got together with Leigh. Now, I should tell you how Leigh Benin and I met. The Metropolitan Philharmonic Chorus did a series of concerts called Songs of Conscience, leading up to the English language premiere of Rusalka, Dr. Mischke's opera, not the Dvorak. This is Dargamuschi's Rosalba 50 years before Dvorak. It's never been done in this country since Chelyabin did it in 1922. We did it at Queen's College in the translation with my mother and me, and the chorus was involved in it, and we did a concert, a preview to it, at the Bryant Library in Roslyn. And Lee's aunt,
Barbara
Schwartz, lived right across the street from Bryant Library. She came, and I said, well, you know, our next project we're thinking of doing is the Triangle Fire. She said, the Triangle Fire? My nephew wrote the book on the Triangle Fire. I have to put you in touch with him. So Lee came to the Rusalka, as did Ellen, because I said to Ellen, I have a feeling that I'm going to find the cast among the Rusalka cast for the Triangle Fire, which is did what it did for the most part. And so Ellen was there, and Lee was there, and we all went out to dinner afterwards and started talking, and Lee gave us this wonderful book and these connections. And then what happened was, after we performed the scene in February, Lee took me to the commemoration last year, right out of Cotton Square here, and we started talking with people, and I told him what we were doing with the why don't you describe the love scene?
Well, the love scene is a love scene between
Max
Blank, one of the two owners,
and
Kate Alterman, a seamstress.
Yes.
And they are in love. He's in love with her, and she spurns him and runs back down to the ninth floor. And he goes off to save himself.
No, you have him save her, actually.
He actually knocks her out, and carries her off to the tenth floor.
Right, no, against your will, yeah.
Is that factual?
No.
That is not. That was the problem.
That was the problem, because once we presented this to Lee and other people that knew something about the Triangle Fire from being relatives of survivors and victims, Lee said in his immortal words, "You are going to offend everybody. You're going to offend the feminists who know that Kate Alterman was a tiger that fought her way to the." To safety through the fire, and there was no damsel in distress. And you're going to offend the people who defend Max Blank, who actually lost several relatives in the fire. He was a family man. He was no lecher or womanizer in that sense. He had two daughters that he grabbed out of the elevator and saved himself, and something like seven of his relatives who also worked there and died in the fire. So we thought about this, and I said, and Helen said, well, you know, this is artistic license. We can take it. And I said, no. We had hit what I call in our New York Archives article a Klinghoffer moment, where John Adams and Alice Goodman were confronted with the Klinghoffer family when they wrote The Death of Klinghoffer, and the family was up in arms. They did not want this opera to happen and have a false story told about their late father, and they really tried to stop it. And Adams and Goodman went on anyway, and there were thousands of pickets, and people actually threatened to burn down the Metropolitan Opera. But they didn't. But I don't think they did the right thing. We did the right thing. We said, no, we're not going to go against the families. And I said that the other night. We got a poem. Truth is stronger than fiction, right? And we went to those books, and we found out exactly what did happen. How Max and Isaac saved people, and Kate called for them to open the doors, and they didn't open the doors, and people died. But I remember the original dialogue was something like, let them burn, it's all about our love, the only thing that's important is our love. No, forget that. So we didn't need that.
I watched the evolution of this, and I would say, even though that was the origin, this particular version took shape when you encountered the character of William Gunn Shepherd, because he gave you the narrator.
Uh-huh.
Do you want to talk about the Brechtian vision had for him?
And this is a shill.
Good question.
Right.
I'm glad you asked that question.
One of my inspirations in writing anything dramatic is Bertolt Brecht, because I like the way that Brecht both draws you in and puts you off. There's a sense of distancing, there's a sense of breaking the empathy, the natural empathy and identification of an audience with characters, because we are not the same as the characters. So
call it M. Fremdel.
No, Fifth Fremdel. Fifth Fremdel.
Estrangement.
Estrangement, right. So John Tribe defined it very beautifully. He said, making the strange familiar and the familiar strange.
Strange, right. So William Gunn Shepherd, who was an actual reporter, a very young reporter, 23, 24 years old, who was the first on the scene, does act as the narrator, and I deliberately made him into almost a circus barker.
Ringmaster or cabaret.
Or cabaret character, because he sort of treats it as a spectacle, and there is this interesting ambivalence we feel. On the one hand, we want to be the same people. It's the same reaction when we pass an accident on the highway and we gape. We want to see how many people have been killed or mangled or hurt, and we're also horrified and want to look away and not feel that. So the fact that he's using this very kind of cavalier and entertainment persona on the one hand to draw us in, and on the other hand he's describing horror, love amid the flames, and all of these horrible
things. And Leonard, you gave him very distinctive music to do that.
Thank you. Well, Bill is my collaborator since 1972. He was Candide to my Pangloss, and he also did an adaptation with me of Roundheads and the Pointed Heads, which is a very important work of Greg and Eisler. He really had his experience in that. And in fact, when Ellen saw him do a very small part in Rosalco, which he made into much more than what it was, she agreed with me, he's the person to do this. And that role was written for him. In fact, just about every person on this stage, I can say, the role was written for them, it was just wonderful having people to write it for. And then, of course, having written it for them and they agreed to do it, then we had to find a way to do the production. And I think this is the first time that Ellen has had a librettist, a composer say, hey, you're going to produce this with me, not just write it and turn it over to the company, right?
Right.
And she did. And Leigh, we've had several, many, many wonderful three-part conversations with Skype and speakerphone. Because Leigh has been just tremendously supportive all the way through this. Did you finally feel that this was the culmination?
Yes. Can you tell us a little bit what happened in the aftermath of the fire?
Well, first of all, I should say, for those who don't know me, that the reason I got involved, not just with the opera, but with the Triangle Choir, is because my grandmother came here in 1912 expecting to get a job through the good graces of her cousin, Rose Harvey. And Rose, by that point, was dead because she was one of the 146 who died in the fire. She was one of the women who jumped from the ninth floor. So when I hear this opera, it's very personal to me. I think about that tragedy in terms of my cousin Rose. You could say justice, in my view, was not done in the courtroom. I think they were guilty. As Max Blank was, even after the whole Triangle Fire and all the lawsuits were finished, he was found guilty of locking a door at another factory they had uptown and fined $25. So even after all these deaths, he still locked the doors. He was an incorrigible SOB. Yes, absolutely. So, for me, the justice wasn't done in the courtroom, but there was a form of historical redemption. And that had to do with basically the creation of what we came to experience as the American liberal order. That is to say, the New Deal really established that. And the New Deal came directly out of the Triangle Fire, according to Francis Perkins, who was having tea on the north side of Washington Square Park on the day of the fire, heard the bells, ran across the park, and got there just as the first woman started to jump. And I sometimes think eerily that maybe Francis Perkins was there watching my cousin jump from the ninth floor and die. But Francis Perkins then, through the politics that you saw, became head of the factory commission in New York, investigating working conditions in all sorts of industries. They passed lots of labor laws, which you heard about, including, I mean, any of these things that we have, doors that open out, exit signs, all of it was enacted back then. And she went on to become the first
female
cabinet member as Roosevelt's Secretary of Labor. And she said to Roosevelt when he offered her the job, I'll only take it if you promise to enact my agenda. What's your agenda? It turned out to be things like the National Labor Relations Act, the Fair Labor Standards Act, and a whole bunch of New Deal provisions which created the conditions for the modern American working class. And that's liberalism with all its positives and all its problems. But it came out of the Triangle Fire. So I
yeah, well, Perkins said at, on the 50th anniversary of the fire, on a dais with Eleanor Roosevelt, that the New Deal began March 25th, 1911.
Yeah, and that wasn't just because she was there. She had the right to say that, because everything that she did or was able to do flowed from that. But it never would have happened, and this is a point I would just like to make. It never would have happened had people not protested. On April the 5th, I think it was, in 1911, it was a cold, rainy April day, and there was a funeral procession for the 6 unidentified victims of the fire. Then unidentified, they've since been identified. But it took 100 years, by the way. But there was a funeral procession that had 100,000 people marching in this cold.
And 300,000 more watching.
And 300,000 more watching. That 400,000 people who were out on the streets that April day, that was 10% of, Yeah, 10% of the entire population of New York, which is 4 million at that time. 10%. And the Tammany politicians who up until that point had sided with the employers against the workers and the uprising of the 20,000 in 1909, 1910, and so on, they suddenly realized that if they didn't do something to help the working class of New York, that they would be out of a job, that they would be thrown out. So it was really the reason we're here today remembering the Triangle Fire on its 106th anniversary. It's for a lot of reasons. You could say, well, it was very visible. The tragedy was visible because the women jumping was such a memorable and such a talked about, a horrible vision. But really, without those 400,000 people out on the street, this it might easily have been forgotten and certainly wouldn't have led to the kind of legislation to protect workers that it did lead to. So the message is, what's the message? The message is,
take
to the streets.
Power to the people.
Yeah.
I would like to, I guess we'd all like to open it up to questions or respond.
I have three quick ones. was the loss of Blank's family brought out by Steuer to get sympathy from the jury? Do we know, number one?
It was a 2,000-page transcript that
right.
I worked from.
Sure.
I do not remember.
I take it there were no women on the jury?
No.
No.
That's
correct.
Vote.
No women.
As Brent is one of
yes.
your lines.
Yes.
Is it related to the song that came out just before?
Well, as Brent is
Kristallnacht.
As Brent is a pun.
It
means, literally, it's burning. And it's also a German expression, which means it's urgent.
It's also the title of the great song.
Yes, I know that. Mordecai the Fifth.
Yes,
I know that.
No relation to that, though.
Except that I knew it and put it in.
No, Leonard put that line in, so he probably did it on purpose.
Oh, yeah. But they were yelling it and screaming, we are burning, and
yes.
it's urgent. You've got to do something. Yes, Brent did that. Right?
Yeah, the other historical footnote is that although Steuer is the villain of the piece, he also has an admired role in American history, which is that his technique of getting a witness to repeat a negative story or negative testimony over and over to try to
discredit
it by showing that it could have been rehearsed, it could have been coached, is now taught in law schools all across America as an example of using this interrogation technique.
Ooh.
Max Steuer's son, Aaron, became a very prominent, highly respected, and a wonderful writer, not only of decisions, but of stories in the law, the many he has published in the New York Law Journal. Aaron Steuer.
Well, he's not all that bad. I mean, he actually did become a New Dealer, as I recall.
Max
Steuer, yeah.
And we actually had his granddaughter, Lynn Steuer, on the panel with us two nights ago.
We were very scared that she was going to react to it if we're talking about Shylock. And she said, I'm sort of the villain here. And Tom spoke, no, I'm the villain. But she I asked her, do you think that we presented him fairly? And she said, yes.
Well, she said, or in the movie,
In the HBO documentary, when she was interviewed, she said two things. She said, one, she told an anecdote of her grandfather being in an elevator and somebody, a stranger, saying, do you know what the weather is like today? And he told her, and he said, I'll send you a bill.
And he did send her a bill, yeah.
For
his opinion.
For his legal opinion. And he also said he demanded to be paid. paid
upfront
for defending these two men, because he says, I can't think without my fee.
Yeah. So I mean, at least, you know, all that matters is my fee. I mean, this was not so outlandish in terms of...
That, by the way, is typical of all criminal defense attorneys. They ought to be paid up front. Because if their client is convicted, they're never going to see it.
That's interesting. Thank you. Okay, Ben is a lawyer. He knows. Yeah, Carol. This is Carol Jocknowitz, whom you all met. She was helping with the book, and there's a really godsend to us.
Well, I wanted to point out that the effects of this tragedy were not only felt in this country in many ways you've been outlining. My husband told me that his father had told him that when this was a day of mourning in Poland, because there were so many families who had sent daughters to this country, who had, everybody had somebody who had somebody who had somebody who was somehow connected. It was, so the circles just went ever outward. And
tell us what you told me about what your grandmother said to your mother.
That is in a different vein, and I'd be delighted to tell you. My mother's mother, my maternal grandmother, was the forelady in a shop that was diagonally across from where we're sitting now. And many in the early years of the 20th century, and some years later when my mother came home from high school one day and said, they were living up in respectable Washington Heights then, and said, I want to go to NYU. My grandmother remembered her youth and was very frightened and said to my mother, those buildings down there aren't safe.
Now I think they are.
I want to say something about the opera. I think it's a beautiful poem.
What's your name?
It's Gary Westifer. I'm a friend of Ellen and Herb's.
Oh, yes.
And I'm here with my husband, Robert. I just want to say it's a beautiful, powerful piece.
Thank you.
And that when you say this is the last performance, I hope you mean that this is the last scheduled performance or no, planned performance, and that we can see it again.
This opera needs a fundraiser.
Well, right, it's the last funded performance.
Well, I'll tell you, this the opera in this form costs about $3,000 per performance. We've done six performances. We raised a little bit more than $18,000. That includes the $2,500 commission we got from the Puffin Foundation, which we applied to the costs, and we've gone a little bit over, so we get to keep some of that, not all of it, we get to keep some of that money. I think to do a production with an orchestra would be about $50,000. We were offered a place at the Judson Memorial Theater. We wanted to do it there in March, and they said no, but they offered us a date in May, and then told us it would cost us $1,500 just to rent the place. Mm-hmm. So we're not going to be doing that. I hope that we will do it again sometime, maybe on a larger scale, but instead of planning the performances and then raising the money, we probably should raise the money first and then...
Unions might be interested in putting it on.
Maybe.
Yeah. I'd like to agree. It was a beautiful performance, very moving. I've also done some studying about this, the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire.
What's your name?
Joan. I'm a retired high school teacher.
Joan?
Just Joan, yeah.
Okay.
But I'm actually a Beckerman. There's another Beckerman here, so we're related.
Oh.
The thing that really moved me was the ending, because I love that you guys brought it to Bangladesh.
Yeah.
And I was teaching during those years, and my students who were Bengali organized a big demonstration. And I think the most powerful thing about it is that it asks us, how do we unlock the door? So I think it's a very timely and relevant piece, and I think that we unlock the door by trying to fight for a system and a movement that's not based on profit. And I know we all probably have different ideas about communism and socialism. I don't think there's a nice form of capitalism. But that we eventually will need a movement where workers run society, and I think this piece should be shown to all the unions. And I welcome you guys to come to my campus and maybe we can get some money.
Where's your campus?
I am South Bronx, Hostos Community College.
Oh, Hostos.
That would be a good place.
So maybe, you know, maybe there's
a... Well, I'll tell you what, talk to the Bronx Opera Company, because we did this in association with them.
Okay.
And in fact, the managing director was here the other night, the director, the artistic director, has not seen the opera, tell him he should see it.
We'll do it.
And...
It'll be on YouTube.
It's all, yeah, it also, there are several performances now, each performance has been videotaped. You can see it, I don't, is the URL on the...
No.
Yeah, tinyurl.com/trianglefire-opera will get you to the webpage that has the links to several excerpts and one complete performance from September 11th at the Public Foundation in Teaneck. And some of these other performances will be are up over there also and will be linked to that page at this point. I think that...
And just to respond to your point also, if you go home tonight and look in the label of whatever you're wearing, just look in your closet, you will see probably that it says Bangladesh or India or
Vietnam
or Trinidad, Honduras. And the truth is that we are all part of that system because obviously after labor laws made it more expensive to manufacture in this country because they had to upgrade conditions, they obviously went elsewhere where they don't have to pay much or have safety codes.
Two things about that. One, Tom Bias put something on his Facebook page today about how he was going to be performing tonight in the building where the fire happened on the date that it happened. And you got a response from somebody named Bork. Do you know this guy?
No.
He said something about, does it ever occur to you that maybe organizing is what created the migration of labor to or of the industry to other countries? And I responded to that. You saw it?
Yeah.
You approve? I said that's like saying that alleviating pain in one organ is useless because it'll just spread to another organ. You've got to alleviate it everywhere. And when you organize, it's got to be international, right?
Absolutely. Okay, look, then it's your stage manager. It's past half past.
What time is it?
It's
10:30.
10:30.